It is my pleasure to introduce today's presenters. Craig Wood is Managing Director and Chief Engagement Officer at 360 Live Media. Neil O'Keefe is the Senior Vice President of CRM and Member Engagement at Direct Marketing Association. Please welcome Craig and Neil.
All right. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. We'd like to welcome our live stream audience. We are rebroadcasting this tomorrow morning, so we are glad to have all of you here. Thank you for sitting close. And as people come in, we'd ask you to sit as close as possible. You are in for a real treat today. Neil O'Keefe from the Direct Marketing Association, formerly now the Data and Marketing Association, has been willing to share a ton of information with you that most associations are not willing to share. So you guys are in for a treat. What I will tell you, as we introduce ourselves here, my role, I'm with the company called 360 Live Media. We are a marketing strategy and experience agency based in Washington, D.C., and we are an association accelerator. We help associations accelerate their growth and their success, not just in their events, but in things like member value, membership, things like that. So Neil, introduce yourself.
I'm the SVP of CRM, as we said earlier, for the Data and Marketing Association. We represent the full ecosystem of the marketing space, from companies like IBM and American Express to Google and Facebook.
Great. So first things first, we want you all to be present and mindful while we're together today, whether you're watching virtually or here with us, which means that you don't have to take any notes, you don't have to do anything but just listen and participate. Everything you see today is going to be available to you. We have a wonderful reprint of an article that Convene magazine wrote on DMA and their and then rebrand. And everything in this presentation, every data point, we will send to you in a PowerPoint or a PDF document if you would like it. We'll give you our emails at the end. It's too big to post on the app, so we'll be happy to send it to you. So feel free to kind of sit back, kick back in one of these seats, and just enjoy it. You have a chock full of information. That's the good news. The bad news is this presentation is chock full of information. And so we've got a lot to go through, and we're going to go, I don't want to say fast, but we're going to go at a pace that allows you guys to sort of take it all in, because there's a story here, a really important story that we're going to tell. You will hit the learner outcomes. Convening Leaders and PCMA would like us to remind you sort of what you came here for, and this is what you'll come out of here with. So we promise to deliver on that at 4:45. We realize we're the last thing between you and your pre-cocktail before the cocktail party tonight, so we'll do our best to keep you entertained. I will tell you that Neil and I have nowhere to go right away, so at 4:45 when we stop, if people want to hang around and ask us some more questions, we're happy to do that. So one of the things we're going to challenge you to do today is think differently about your event. And so we thought we'd start by just asking you to think differently just in general. We'll have a little mental floss here, if you will. This will take just a second. I'm going to ask you what this sequence of numbers represents. Does anybody know what this sequence of numbers represents?
A phone number.
Phone number. Good guess, but wrong.
Dave Lutz's
Social Security number. Everybody write that down. Dave Lutz right there. It is not Dave Lutz's Social Security number. It requires you to look at these numbers in a different way. What way could you look at these numbers that might make this pattern a little bit more logical?
Close.
Chronological, close, broken up, close.
I had to Google it.
Backwards, close. We're looking at them as numbers, not as letters. What if you looked at them as letters? It's alphabetical. Alphabetical. Those are the 10 digits alphabetically done. You have to think and look at things through a different lens. Let's try one more. What about this one? What does this sequence of letters represent? Somebody's got this one. While you think about it, Chase, would you start the clock for us, my friend? Thank you. Think of them not as letters, but now think of them as numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Ah, yes, the collective sigh of, oh, we should have got that. So that's what we want you to do today. Put away all your preconceived notions about your event, about your trade show, about your association meeting, whatever the case is, and think about it differently. Neil and I are going to challenge you to do that today, and hopefully your brain will allow you to sort of not see numbers but see letters, and not see letters but see numbers. So let's get this thing started. If you know the famous words of Simon Sinek, no one cares what you do or how you do it until they know why you do it. So that's sort of how we structured today's discussion for you. was to talk to you about why in the world would the DMA, a 98-year-old brand at the time, rebrand its annual event. Neil's going to walk you through really the context, because that's maybe the most important part of this story. It's not about the name. It's the name of the session. It's more than the name, the power of event rebranding. It's about what the association wanted to do. Then we're going to dig really deep, and you can thank Neil for this, to tell you exactly what they did and how they did it. So we're going to show you across really all 9 P's sort of what the DMA did differently to take this 98-year-old event and really reboot it, reinvent it, kickstart it into the next generation. And then finally, Neil will close with a little bit about what's working, what's changing, and what's next, because it's not just about what happened, in this case, 2015 when it was launched, but more about sort of what's coming up after that. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Neil, and I'm going to walk to the other side so I can give some love to this side of the room.
Thanks, Craig. Thank you, everybody, for coming. What was interesting working with 360 is that mind floss that we just went through. The first time I walked into the office down in Washington, we sat in a large room. It's exactly not those two examples, but the type of process that we went through each time we got together. So it made us think differently. Craig's asking why rebrand, and he mentioned the fact that we were a 98-year-old organization. We had a 98-year-old show, and it was 98 years old. It was old. We needed to do something different. We saw declines in our membership. We were worried about evolving our brand. For 98 years, we're an association. For 85 plus, we're driven by mail, because that's all there was. The vice president of marketing, when I first came in to the industry, was the vice president of print, of catalog or mail. Now the vice president of marketing has to know 20 different things, and it's constantly changing. We run 6 events. By far, and then is the centerpiece, our main event, and it's built around an exhibit floor, and that presented a lot of challenges for us. So we felt there was a lot of changes that needed to be done. This quote from Jack Welch is terrific. If the change outside of you is moving faster than the change inside, you're in trouble. The end is near. And we recognize that. And we had good people in the organization that helped us recognize that and helped us make further changes. We had the heritage, you know about that. The center of the universe was changing, the world was changing, and we had just gotten a new CEO. And thankfully, the CEO saw the need to change, and he was not too proud to go out and ask people to help, and most importantly, to go to our board and to solicit the input from the board. We have a collective group, as I mentioned before. We represent companies like American Express and IBM and Facebook and Adobe and Oracle. They're all members of our board as well. So we leaned on that group pretty hard. If you could, Craig. We didn't forget the past. We built on the past. So if you look at if you know some of the names on the bottom, from J. Walter Thompson on the left to David Ogilvy in the middle, we built up off of them, so that we had Malcolm Gladwell and Tim Cook and Sheryl Sandberg. So we didn't neglect our past, but we built upon it. And we knew that the membership builds upon that too. We've been looking at data and focusing on data regardless of the channel, and that was the core bond. But the industry was evolving, it was changing, and it was changing much faster than we were. What's constant is that we had a core group of companies that are part of the association, and we've built on that. So we had a solid foundation. We felt we could make that change. Companies like Hearst and IBM that have been with us for nearly the full 100 years that we've been in existence. And then building on them with other financial service brands, and then the data providers, the data analytics companies. And then now, over the last 5 to 10 years, building that out around companies like Google and MediaMath that are on the cutting edge of doing the data and analytics that the marketing industry prides itself on today. So we sat back, not for long, we sat back and we looked at what were we doing, what were we doing well, what were we not doing so well. And we were doing some things well, but we weren't thought leaders. We weren't providing a stage and a podium for our members to be thought leaders, and for an association, that might be the most important thing that you can do. So that's where we focused. That was a high need and a low satisfaction area. And if you look at the slide that's up there now, you can tell we didn't even have a consistent approach over the years past. And we looked old. We looked like every other conference. And that's what we looked like. We looked like a conference. We had no logo, just the year, kept changing, different city, different year. You're all familiar with Net Promoter Score. These are the best that are out there, the Apples, the Trader Joe's, the Amazons of the world. They're in the 70s and the 80s if they're lucky. We were 3. That probably took, in that meeting, when we realized that and looked closely, that was probably the biggest attention-getting moment in terms of the need for change. And what really caught our attention with the folks at 360 is when we were looking at that, and we told ourselves over the years that we had great speakers and great sessions and thousands of people coming through the doors, but we had a 3. So we were broken. And we recognized the fact that we were broken. And we needed to do something about it. And I mentioned to you that we're proud of the board. One of the reasons when I signed on with DMA, I've been a member of the DMA 20 plus years. I was most recently in the CRM group at Home Depot and worked with a company called Spiegel Brands for a long time. When I saw who the board had changed to and had met Tom Benton, this group was leaning in. They wanted to affect change. They were open to the idea of changing the industry, in part, changing the association, changing the event, in part because their companies were going through a lot of the same things. IBM is going through a lot of the same things at a much different scale. R.R. Donnelly, who's a printer, who split themselves into 3 different organizations and focusing on digital print and RFID chips, has been around for 100 years. They're all wrestling with the same need for change that we were, and these companies were willing to lean in. We had a board committee that we pulled together. It was important. They didn't just all nod their heads around the table. People got their hands dirty. And there were members of the DMA board who formed a committee, and that committee, different people on it, still exists today. So as we get ready for our next event this coming October, there's still a board committee that's working with us on this event. The feedback from one of the people in the board who was on the committee is the whole event needs to be completely rethought. How do we start over? Let's open everything up to be challenged. There's no sacred cows. Let's look at everything that we have.
That's where we pick up the story here. So that was the mandate from the board. And if you looked at the introduction slide, you saw that I'm actually a former DMA board member. So I was there in some of those discussions. And what impressed me about those roughly 40 people on the board was their conviction, their courage, and their commitment. This was not about the event. It was about the association and what was needed to take the association to the next level. 98 years, Neil had a slide that showed declining membership. This was about what are we going to do for the next 98 years for the Direct Marketing Association at the time. And so to have that conviction, that courage, and that commitment to do what's right, to completely rethink your annual event, but use it as a blasting cap, a Trojan horse, if you will, for what the association needed to do. And that's the story we're going to tell you here and now. What does that mean? So yes, the board says it needs to be completely rethought. What does that mean? And that's what we're going to talk about for the next 30 or 40 minutes together. And we are going to get some chance to interact with each other in just one brief moment. One of the important things, though, that we realize as a board and that it's important for you and in your organizations to think about, it's never just about the event. Unless you're an event-only company, it's never just about the event. We heard about Mark Benioff and Salesforce and Dreamforce yesterday in a panel that our CEO, Don Neal, was a part of. And, you know, she talked about, you know, that Mark sees his title as CEO, the chief event officer. But that's not the only thing they do. But Dreamforce is a launching pad for 170,000 people to embrace and engage with the Salesforce brand. It's never just about the event. It's about this kind of stuff. It's about the actual value proposition of the membership. It's about the organizational structure, the members, the team you have, the leadership, and what alternatives? Why even have an event? And those are the types of questions you get into when you really get open yourself up to challenging yourself, do we really need an event, and what's it going to look like, and how are we going to completely rethink it? Now, today, we're going to talk about the event. So I don't want to mislead you. There's a lot that we could talk about. Neil and I could do an all-day session on this, and we'd be happy to if anybody's interested. But today we're going to spend, you know, the next 30 minutes talking about the event itself. But just know that it's never just about the event. One of the things the DMA board embraced was something that we call the six R's at 360. It's a lens to which you can think about your event, think about your association, and begin to understand that your event is a business. Your event is a product. And the six R's up here on the screen are really, really critical. The first is relevant. Are you relevant? Do you have the right center of gravity for your event and for your association? That's the question the DMA grappled with. What's the relevance of our event these days and the relevance of our association in this evolving data and marketing industry? What about the reputation? How do we use the event to accelerate our dominance in the marketplace? There was only really one direct marketing association, but the rate of change on the outside was changing more than the rate of change on the inside. How do we establish an advocacy position that our event would help to solidify? Are we reaching the largest percentage of our addressable audience? Are we getting the people we should get? You're going to hear a story in a few minutes that the DMA was not. The next generation of marketers are already here. They're not coming. They're here. And were they coming to DMA's annual event? And if they were coming, were we retaining them? What was the retention of those people, both in membership as well as in the show itself? And then finally, the numbers. I was talking to someone today on a brain date. If you haven't done a brain date, you should do a brain date. You should do lots of brain dates, which goes against what I was told in high school, but you should do a lot of brain dates at PCMA Convening Leaders. And we talked about the fact that when you talk to the CFO of an organization or a board, you gotta talk numbers, obviously. Revenue and ROI are the last two R's. What does the show contribute to your top line? What's it contribute to your bottom line? And then what's the return on the investment you're making there? Those six R's, I will tell you right now, are the lens in which any, serious board is looking through it. They're not worried about some of the stuff that maybe as meeting planners, meeting professionals that we think about on a daily basis. They're thinking about, are we getting the right people there? How is it helping our reputation? What's it doing for the relevance of the industry? So we're going to ask you guys just to take a second to engage with each other. We're going to ask you, if you would, talk to your table neighbors here, turn around to talk to someone next to you, and answer the question, which one of these R's is the highest priority for your event right now? And how does that differ for the priority for your association? So which of the R's is most important for your event, and how does that change or differ with your association? So we'll put a little music on. Chase will put a little music on. We'll spend just a couple of minutes talking about the six R's. Excellent interaction at 3:45, 3:50 today. So who's got the courage, the conviction, and the commitment to share with us what their number one R is for their association event right now, or their event in general? Yes. Relevance. Why relevance?
Because if you're not relevant, you're not going to have any revenue.
Amen, sister. We get asked that question. If we have to rank them, relevance is why we talk about it first, because that's right. If you're not relevant, some of those others. Other people, who has another R that they were focused on for their event? Yes, ma'am.
We right now are struggling mostly with retention.
Okay. You can see the interconnectivity of these R's very clearly when you start talking about that. And we see that a lot with events that travel from city to city. Unless you're the Aspen Ideas Festival or South By in Austin or something like that, you deal with the fact that people aren't going to always travel. And how do you retain those people year over year over a period of time? How about one more? I saw another hand. Is there someone else? Yes, ma'am.
My association's 120 years old, and I would say it's reach, because we have a very loyal fan base that comes back year after year. But obviously, at some point, they're going to retire. So I would say it's reaching new audiences and responding to the needs of those new audiences.
Great. Thank you. And thank you for making the DMA feel like a young whippersnapper at 98 years old. So that's perfect. So I told you guys you're going to get a copy of this deck if you'd like it. I would ask you to start thinking about your event through these six R's. Start to challenge yourself as you make decisions, is how is this going to impact our relevance, our reputation? As you think about your keynotes, as you think about the way you're setting up education and programming, start to look at these six R's as a way to begin to think differently about the important role your event plays in your association. So I told you we're going to focus a little bit more on the event in this particular session. So we like to talk about the 9 P's of marketing. So we see your event as a product. It's a product. People hire your event to do a job. They hire it to get CEUs. They hire it to network and meet people. They hire it to be a family reunion and connect with people they haven't seen in a long while. But because it's a product, it's got benefits and rewards, and you need to think about price and place and promotion and how it's performing and how you're packaging it. And so as the DMA went through this reevaluation of the DMA annual event, as it was called in 2014, we looked at all 9 P's. Today we're going to focus on 7 of them, just to make it easy. We're not going to spend a lot of time on the pricing structure or the place. DMA is an event that has traditionally traveled all kinds of different places, has not had a rotation of regular cities. So in this case, we're not going to spend much time. We were launching in Boston. We knew it was going to be LA after that, then New Orleans for the 100th year, so there was a rotation already in place there. All right? So purpose is by far the number one P. You got to know the job that it's being hired to do. And if you even position the DMA on a sort of traditional positioning axis here, if you think a trade show, an association conference, that's really what, for 98 years, the DMA's event was. It was a traditional trade show conference for an association. I went to 23 of them in my 27 years of living. Thank you for laughing and enjoying that. You got it too, yeah. The rest of the audience is going to get it later on. They're going to be hysterical about it in a little while. I say it's not bad. The trends there, that's just what people have continued to do. Is if you look at your event, many of your events are the same event they were 10, 20, 40, 50, 98 years ago. You got didactic learning sessions, it's all classroom style. You've got the same kind of speakers. At the DMA, we had the exact same speakers for lots of years, and I was I was one of them. But you kept getting invited back because you got highly rated and people liked hearing from you, but you weren't getting in the new talent. That's what DMA was. What they and we identified was this blue ocean, that what more and more people in the marketing industry, and I will argue that people across the board are looking for, is a different kind of experience. Not an event, but an experience. And not a traditional association conference trade show, but something that felt more like a curated thought leadership forum, merged with sort of a user conference and applied learning, because there's still a role for exhibitors and a role for sponsors. Think of it as the Aspen Ideas Festival meets Dreamforce, meets some sort of hosted buyer environment that allows people to really connect with the solutions they need. That was the blue ocean for the DMA. How do we get that? Because that's what I want to be a part of. I want to be a part of people who are smart and understand what's happening and are thought leaders, with other people sharing the same concerns I have and challenges I have in the marketing space, with exhibitors, partners, vendors, industry partners, whatever term you want to use, who can help me solve my problems. Because that's really what people want to do, is solve their problems. They don't want to buy a product. They want to solve their problems. So that's where we went to aspirationally and what this new event was going to be all about. And to do that, we had to paint a vision for a from to. What are we going from today, and what are we going to tomorrow? And I'm not going to read you all these, but I think you can really see sort of the pillars, if you will, of what this event was going to be. It was going to be a new experience. It wasn't going to be an event. It was going to be from an 80s model to a 21st century model. It was going to be year-round curriculum, year-round business partners. Instead of a call for papers, we're going to look at faculty who treat the audience as students, faculty who treat the audience as people who are there to learn, not people who are there to necessarily or be presenting in a way that is going to be, it seemed like, a call to papers. From general sessions to a choreographed experience over the course of the 3 days. At the time, actually, it was 6 days. We actually shortened it. From a registration fee to a subscription pricing model, you're buying tickets to this event. You're not registering for it. From being DMA-centric to audience-centric, and an integrated media strategy. So we often say in the marketing industry that the cobbler's kids don't have very good shoes. And in many ways, the model in which DMA was delivering their prize asset, this event was not consistent with what was happening in the marketing space. So that was the purpose. That was the big P of what we're trying to do and achieve. But we didn't know the people. We didn't know the audience that was coming and the audience that wasn't coming. So DMA and 360 engaged in a very in-depth analysis of the audience. And I will tell you one thing that DMA has that most of you may not have is a lot of data. You would expect as the Data and Marketing Association, as Direct Marketing Association. So they looked at 100,000 plus data records. We did in-depth interviews. We had a board, as Neil said, and curators of 60 plus people. And we did a series of surveys totaling a little over 500 people to really get an understanding of what people wanted from the Direct Marketing Association at the time and what that looked like. And the insights were pretty interesting. I'm not going to read this to you, but you can see there were four sort of major key insights: a need for unity, demand, understanding where the next marketing dollars was going, and the results over process. Just show me some results. And it led us to the idea that there was a generation of marketers that we were not reaching, a generation that was digital by nature, driven by data, and disruptive by temperament, and those who feel like they create demand with a capital D. And so we actually created the audience, this manifesto, for Gen D, Generation D. I know there's lots of Gen X and Gen Y and Gen Z, but there wasn't a Gen D, and more importantly, it was about being disruptive, digital by nature, driven by data. And this was a manifesto we wrote. And I think that's important because it began to galvanize for the DMA, for the marketing industry in general, and for the community that they were trying to gather, who is it that we are as a movement? We're not yesterday's marketers. We're not the picture of the older gentleman that Neil showed before the center of the eye of gravity. We are driven by results, performance, and impact. We are a new generation of modern, empirical, integrated media mavens and creatively inspired makers. That's who's marketing today, guys, at Facebook and Google and other places. And that's who the Direct Marketing Association needed to reach. So this manifesto became the way in which we communicated, talked about, wrote the stories, and told the narrative of who this new target audience or target audiences needed to be. But we also knew the expectations were changing. How many of you feel like you compete against these events? I see one hand. There is a right and wrong answer to this question, and most of you got this question wrong. The right answer is you all compete against these different things. Because this is what's saying the expectation of today's consumer, today's people, about how experiences should be. The Aspen ideas was how they do church these days, or, you know, the mega churches. You see Willow Creek and Saddleback up there. The way they do them, the way they engage small groups, the way they take tens of thousands of people and make it feel like an intimate, personal experience is not just about the God part of it. Take that aside for a second. It's about how they'll be able to bring people together of like minds with similar issues who want to talk about things with people who can help them solve their problems. You get the same thing at Aspen, at Bonnaroo, at Burning Man, whatever you want to say. TED Talk has changed the expectation of what your event should be. So you're competing with this today. They may not be buying a ticket to one of these versus yours, but they are saying, am I going to get what I just got from that TED Talk? Because I could probably watch that. Am I going to get the same kind of thought leadership or somewhere close to what I might be able to get at a place like Aspen or South By? So we identified collectively roughly these, 28, roughly 30 profiles of people that were needed to be a part of the DMA experience, if you will. We certainly couldn't serve all of them, so we found five core segments that were going to drive who the new DMA was and who the new brand of the event was going to be. And I just want to show you very quickly, there's a little bit more detail in the PowerPoint that you'll get because we don't have time to go through all of it, but you've got Sarah. Sarah was an ambitious seeker. She wants education. She wants to understand actionable insights that she can really use to drive her career and drive her performance in her current job and future job. And the DMA knew who she was and what she wanted and how did they reach her and what her perceptions were of the DMA and what profile information, what do we say, and most importantly, sort of what's going to sort of be her viewpoint of herself. But guess what? She's coming to their annual event in a very different mindset than Marcus is. Marcus is a strategic networker. It's all about moving up. It's all about connecting. It's all about the things he needs to do to continue to build relationships with the best minds out there so he can rub elbows with those marketing geniuses. And by the way, Marcus is nothing like Diane, who's a focused leader. She's looking for answers. She's looking for solutions to problems. Who's nothing like Christy, inspired creative, who's looking for ideas and innovation in the future, compared to David, the driven visionary. They had to create five shows within a show because it's five different personas, five different audience profiles of people who are expecting different things from that one organization. And that's what Gen D is all about. Gen D is not all about finding that people all share the same attitudes and values and aspirations, but being able to differentiate them, distinguish them, and bring them to life in a way that would create a unique, intimate experience for them that was unlike anything they could get anywhere else. The small group setting at church or synagogue that you can't find at other association events.
When we went through the exercise and the profile that built out the personas, we thought we needed to redefine the customer. And as I was building out this slide, it was, we don't need to redefine them. We need to define them. We need to start all over again. Because we thought we had a ton of data and a profile, but it took this exercise to get to the point where we realized that that change that we said was moving so fast outside of the business and not as fast as the change inside of the business required us to take a full step back. So without having that view of the customer, without having that definition of who they were, we couldn't even start to build the content, let alone create the segments to market to them. And we're still, every marketer is constantly working on segmentation and personalization and relevance. But until we defined who they were, until we used those different personas, we couldn't get there. But now, starting in 15 and even more so each year, we're developing more content that's more personal, more relevant to the attendee, and then we're delivering marketing communications that's also more personal and more relevant.
Great. So just a quick show of hands, how many of you have a segmentation scheme for your event? How many of you segment your audience in traditional ways and in behavioral ways, who's been there before, or demographically? Does someone do something creatively? And sorry, for those of you watching the live stream, you can chat and we'll respond to that. Is there anybody doing anything that's innovative, if you will, around the segmentation world? Okay. A little less interaction than we had last time, but we'll work on that. That's okay. What I will tell you, though, is there, you need to start. There are six ways to segment an audience, which are sort of the basic ways. There's demographic, firmographic, economic, psychographic, sort of attitudinally, and behaviorally, and transactionally. So if you think about how you're starting to talk to your people, not all millennials are made alike, guys. You can't treat all millennials the same. You can't treat all women the same. You can't treat all people who were there last year the same. So the idea of differentiating the segment, the journey map for people, DMA did it in a very sophisticated way. It doesn't take that much sophistication to begin to take, if you're not doing much, take it to the next level. All right, so we've spent a little bit of time on the purpose and the people, which are really the two most important P's to help develop the product, to help develop the P of the, what is the experience we're delivering? And for DMA, it was about understanding all four dimensions that 360 talks about in the layers, if you will, of the experience. There's a physical layer. Convening Leaders does a great job of creating a different physical environment with tables and soft chairs and hard chairs and traditional, so that you could pick where you might learn best, despite your presenter asking you to move up front so you could be closer. But that's what the physical layer of the event's all about, the physiological, the body. Are you giving people booze and donuts and sugar and all the stuff that's going to make them tired and big? Chicken meals at the 2 o'clock, you're going to fall asleep in the more than a brand name presentation, or you're giving them smoothies and wheatgrass shots and things that are going to help you be a little bit more upbeat and energetic at your best as opposed to at your worst. The emotional connection, how are you helping people connect with each other in a more personal, intimate way, brain datey way, if you will. And then finally, if those other three things are in place, you have created the best conditions to help them with the intellectual aspects of it. The educational piece. But guess what? If you're not getting enough sleep, if your chair is uncomfortable, if you don't know anybody, you're sitting by yourself in the corner, you're not going to learn a lot. And so DMA took this approach of how do we do all of these four things in a way that's going to look different than we've ever done. So here was the concept map for what the new DMA event was going to look like. Now, I guess that doesn't look a lot like what some of you guys have. There was a central hub, this arc reactor, if you will, the Robert Downey Jr. Iron Man sort of thing, when put in the heart of the DMA event, was going to pulse out a way and a connection that was going to, you know, attract people and give the DMA these, if you will, superpowers. They delivered on that. They delivered on these team zones and the inspiration zone, the content labs, and the meetup zone. It was about creating a different physical environment that allowed people to learn differently and engage differently. It was about different kinds of tracks, which I'm not going to spend much time on, but just understanding really what these five segments wanted and how we could sort of be not all things to all people, but the right things to the right people. And then maybe most importantly, they delivered or developed five different delivery styles of meetings. So you didn't always sit and hear Craig and Neil talk with a PowerPoint. Matter of fact, in the ignition sessions were small group discussions, and the one rule we had for the moderators was no PowerPoint. Couldn't use PowerPoint. You had to find another way to engage. You had to draw, you had to sing, you had to dance, but you couldn't use PowerPoint. They went from macro sessions to meta to micro to really allow people to engage in different ways. That's what sort of recreating your product looks like and what it feels like when you understand your purpose and you understand your people. You can take and build a product that's going to be very different than what your members and attendees have been used to looking at. So that gets to the branding part of it. That gets to the name part. So we entitled this session More Than a Name, The Power of Event Rebranding, because it is more than a name. We're going to show you the name and tell you why we came to the name, but the name is based on the audience, it's based on the product, and it's based on sort of what DMA wanted to convey to the marketplace in ways they hadn't conveyed before. Simply put, a brand is a promise. A brand is a promise, and the good brands that do it out there, the Apples, the Starbucks, and those, they're making promises they keep at every interaction. The DMA has a brand as an organization, and the DMA annual conference at Expo had a brand as an event. And it was a promise that many people didn't really want anymore, necessarily. We had to build a brand that was going to be a promise for the new DMA, and we had four criteria. It had to have the soul of this Generation D, of this Gen D. It had to be distinctive. It had to be different. There's lots of marketing conferences out there. Lots of them. So Neil and team had to compete with maybe a different competitive set than some of you have. It had to inspire. It had to inspire this next generation, and it had to endure. And so as we went through different options and we gave DMA different choices, we had to talk about the truth, what was going to be important. The truth is this: marketers are relentless. They're never satisfied. They're always seeking something better. Test and control. This worked. Let's see if something else works. Let's try to mail these people now. Let's try to do this segment. Marketers are known to be able to be creative in terms of what they're doing. And this quote really summed it up, which is old ways will always remain unless someone invents a new way and then lives and dies for it. And we thought, what's the hook of this branding campaign? It's that. Let's do that. Let's create something, invent something. Let's invent a new way to do a marketing conference and then find a way to live and die for it. And so there came the advent of and then. The idea that marketers are storytellers. Marketers always have a story. It's always this, and then I did this, and then I did this, and then I tried this. Never satisfied, relentless seekers. And then, which is a crazy name, and there were less crazy names, but the DMA's courageous board said that's the one we want because that's what's going to distinguish us, because that's who we are. We're always looking for what's next. And then became the global marketing experience. That first year, you don't see DMA anywhere in this initial lockup. We had some connection. We did a little changes in 2016, but you can see, and then the global marketing experience was like, what? What is that? Who's putting this on? And as a DMA board member, I'll tell you that many people said, this can't be the DMA putting on and then, because it's not like anything the DMA has ever done. The personality was high energy and motivated and competitive. The tone was a very confident, straightforward, passionate yet aspirational tone to the brand. It was a different voice than the DMA ever had. And the look and the people who we think exemplified the brand were different. Does anybody know who this is? It's Blake Makowski, who's the founder of Tom's Shoes. So he, besides being an incredibly good-looking man, he also is, you know, has a great story to tell. And so the campaign began around turn your passion into your story and then turn your story into something bigger, something that matters. And then turn your story. That next generation of marketers knows who Blake Makowski is and wants to hear him speak. And we went places that you wouldn't normally go for DMA in terms of to advertise. And we brought in a different level of speaker, entertainer, etc. DMA went from one keynote speaker to four. Went from a marketing genius to John Legend, Blake Makowski, Kevin Roberts, and John Iwata, who's the CMO of IBM, who then announced the new Watson campaign right there on the end-to-end stage. Instead of having a traditional concert, they brought in the Goo Goo Dolls. So you're probably saying, did that cost a lot of money? And the answer is yes, because that's what happens when you have to do this. You have to invest in this, and that's where the board's courage comes in. They said, we're committed to doing this right, to send a different message. We can't do what we call better sameness. We can't get to the point where everything is just a little bit better. We have to really use this as a blasting cap. And that's what you do when you bring in John Legend and Blake Makowski and change the way the hub looks and change the way the programming is done, et cetera. So it was a very different event than you would ever expect, and it was packaged differently. You're launching a brand, you're launching something that no one's ever known of, and then meant nothing to no one. So what do? So we created a 1950s-style product campaign. That's how you launch a product, right? So look, and then clarifies creative direction. Oh, I'm happy, and I'm wiping the window. And we did ads that talked about, you know, it's going to be different. And there's a little bit of DMA, a DMA event, but most of the time it's the global marketing experience. Talked about and then being relieved pain caused by tight deadlines. No one likes a good Preparation H joke. You know, Sue's irritated strategists. But the idea was, and Neil will see this, this was one of the most talked about DMA campaigns out there because they had never seen anything like it from DMA. And DMA suddenly had permission to talk about their event in a way they never had. Because who would have the courage to do this ad?
I didn't.
Neil did. Neil had the courage to do this ad. We won't ask why or what if you knew what the blue pill was, but Neil had the courage to do this ad to cure marketing dysfunction. So that's what the DMA was able to do by reinventing the entire event, if you will, by rethinking about everything, not just the brand itself. They couldn't do this if they were delivering the same product, guys. They couldn't deliver the same product and make a promise that says it's going to cure marketing dysfunction. Can't do it. The look and feel was different. You'll see it's a bright and airy. We did guerrilla marketing. We delivered 200 donuts. Matter of fact, Amanda Mitchell's in the room right up here. Amanda is right there on the truck. Amanda was one who went to 200 agencies in Boston and hand-delivered donuts and said, please come to And Then. It's a different kind of event you've ever been to. They drove this truck around in the rain for 7 days, and that's the kind of thing you need to do when you launch a new brand. And the brand's evolved. So one of the things we did get feedback was, is this just another DMA event, or is it the DMA event? So the 2016 lockup was the DMA annual event. We now could bring the DMA back into it because people had heard about it and understood it. The look and feel was different. We went from a darks in Boston to the brightness of LA. Remember I told you that they were on to LA the next year? The look and feel was different. There's palm trees versus some of the blackness. And you'll sort of see the colors and the things that we did. Simon Sinek was one of those people that spoke this year, Magic Johnson, Beth Comstock. So that is what happened. I think the most important thing now is let's talk about what worked. Because not everything works in an event like this. Neil's going to walk you through what I think is the most impressive set of slides you'll see at a Convening Leaders. It's someone willing to share with you their what's working, what's not working, and real hard numbers. So again, you don't have to write these down. We'll send them to you. And I'll turn it back over to you, Neil.
Thanks, Craig. Craig's right. First off, I got dragged to do that blue pill ad. I was nervous. Nervous as all get out, putting that out there. Not everything worked. And you know, that social campaign had mixed results in terms of, you know, clicks and likes and shares and all that fun stuff. But the one thing that campaign did, and Craig just mentioned it, was a ton of people said, wow, you guys are doing something different. And when we asked before, what's the most important thing about the R's, and somebody said relevance, and you have to have relevance, otherwise you're irrelevant and everything else is irrelevant. Those ads let everybody know that we were doing something different, to pay attention. And one of the trade articles that got written was, and then DMA does something different. And that was, if we wanted to achieve anything that first year, I mean, you want to be profitable and attract as many people as possible, but we wanted to let the marketing community know that we were doing something different. So reach is an important part of that. You got to, in order to let people know you're doing something different, you got to make sure you're talking to as many relevant people as possible. We attracted over 5,000 attendees, but the most important piece to me and to the team was that we were attracting new people. We were attracting people that hadn't been to the event before, to the annual event. Now keep in mind, it's a 100-year-old event. Who in the marketing business hadn't gone to DMA before? Well, we not only found people who hadn't gone to the event, we matched them up against the database. Over half of them weren't even in the database. They weren't even doing business with the DMA from an education standpoint or any of our other events. So we'd always looked at our conferences, our events, as things in and of themselves. And Craig's right, he had the list of what we're competing. We're also competing against some of our members' events. I mean, Dreamforce and Adobe and Oracle are all putting on incredible thought leadership events. And we needed to break through. We needed to be different than those guys. The Net Promoter Score went up a lot. It's still not anywhere near 70 or 80, but it's at 17. It's a lot better than where it was before. Attendees versus exhibitors is probably important to all of you. We don't want to have what our biz calls a supplier, a B2B or S to S, supplier versus supplier. They want to talk to brands. They want to talk to the attendees. So seeing that number go up was important. All access passes as opposed to the experience zone only. The all access tickets we charge more. So that was good for revenue. We wanted to see people come in and engage with the entire event. We moved up the ladder in terms of moving from analyst to manager, director, and VP. So that moved for us. So the mix of who was coming was important to us. The reputation for DMA is all, a big part of that is getting them to experience our marketing. You use the cobbler kids don't have good shoes. DMA's marketing has been accused of a lot of things. Cutting edge and awesome, not since I've been around. So we wanted to make sure people were experiencing DMA in a different way. We were measuring the engagement of email, not just how many we pushed out, the impressions and how long people stayed on the site. All of these things went up. One of the big things we really got a lot of good feedback on was the changes we made in our mobile app. So people were engaging with the Direct Marketing Association, the DMA, in many more digital ways, much less than in a print perspective. The sessions, the relevance of what we produced, we needed to measure whether or not it was relevant. 43% increase in the rooms. For better or worse, we had problems because we had standing room only issues. We had people complaining that there was no room to get into a lot of our sessions. Now, I don't want to have people sitting on the floor, but God, if it's a choice between sitting on the floor and nobody in the room, I'm going to pick sitting on the floor. We'll do our best to fix it the following year. Satisfaction, 70% were satisfied. The big sessions, we all are on first name basis now with John and Blake and John. We had over 1,200 people in the room, and part of the reason we know all of this, if you go to the next, we used RFIDs in our badges. So another part of getting into a little bit more cutting edge and demonstrating that we walk the walk. So these numbers are only really measurable by doing and testing things like that. We want to do more with beacons going forward, but we used RFIDs in 15. So we saw that 89% of them came on to the experience zone floor. The hub had a big part in that. That created an excitement and a buzz compared to some of the standard old style exhibit booths that are still part of the floor. And we're still wrestling with that, trying to, how do we continue to move change? We measured the furthest point in the floor. We put readers on the furthest point. We had readers all around the hub to see how many people stayed with the hub. And we didn't just make the app as a way to find out what the next session was. We allowed people to engage, and we had over 3,000 submissions. The provider for the app for us told us per user we had the most interaction that they'd ever seen on the app before. The all access pass, I mentioned those were up. Revenue, I can't share exact numbers. I have people at home that'll watch this and probably critique me for sharing as much as I have, but on the supply side and the exhibitor side, we created a sense of buzz that we were doing something different. We needed to do that. And when we look at the combined efforts, our we've always been reliant on exhibits, and our sponsorship dollars went up. So people saw an overall positive in the change. So we exceeded our expectations on sponsorship, so that was good. ROI, this is where I definitely have to kind of cut short specific numbers, but I'll be honest, our cost per attendee went up. You know, that's in and of itself, if we were doing the same old thing, that'd be a huge problem. You know, we want to manage that back down. But I mentioned to you before that the quality of the person walking through the door and how long they stayed and how many were in each room, all of that went up. So the amount I'm willing to spend on that person is going to go up. I mentioned before, we marketed the event as an event in and of itself. As an association, we want to use the event to leverage people to engage with the association. The same way the Adobes, the Oracles, and the Salesforces do. They're not looking at the event as just a moneymaker. They're looking at the event as a way of engaging people and establishing that relevance and that engagement. And I think that's the biggest change coming out of the rebranding is our looking at the event and how it plays a significant role in the association. So what's next? We've kind of stumbled over the name of the event. I think I let the cat out of the bag too early and called it And Then. We got introduced as the Direct Marketing Association. The logo on the slide say DMA as the Data and Marketing Association. But the rebranding of the event caused us to seriously think about the association itself and the need to change the name. And when we wrote the manifesto and when we built out the ads, the thing at the core was data, and it was data-driven. And we wanted to go there. And we embraced the ampersand. So we went with the Data and Marketing Association. We unveiled that in LA. We're probably out a little past our skis on this in terms of the name and the logo are out there, and we're getting caught up with the branding. But it's a positive thing for us, and we want to celebrate that throughout our 100th year. And we're not looking back, just like before. We haven't forgotten our past, but we want to talk about what are we going to do the next 100 years with companies like Oracle and Adobe and Microsoft and Symantec. Those are some of our newest board members. So the influx of new ideas and cool new brands continues.
He's never read a newspaper and never will. She'll never drive a car. It will drive her. She'll make her first camera with a 3D printer. She'll think Snapchat is for old people. Imagine the world in 20 years. How will businesses reach people? What will consumers want? How will companies tell a cohesive story across limitless channels? It all comes down to one fundamental thing: data. For 100 years, it's been our secret weapon, helping us connect people to products that made life easier and inspire generations. From the beginning, we've known it's not just about channels, it's about insights. It's understanding what's truly important to people that lets you connect the dots when most don't even see dots. And no matter what the future brings, this simple belief will remain. Whoever understands people the best wins. Introducing the new DMA, the Data and Marketing Association.
That got introduced in LA, and like any event, the very next day we started talking about New Orleans. So we're headed to New Orleans this October, and we're continuing the changes. I'm sure there'll be more significant changes as we go along. I know I'm going to do more mobile. Video is becoming more important. The live feed today, that's something that we wrestle with, whether or not we want to do a live feed out. We've been reluctant to go there, but maybe that'll change for our 100th birthday. Taking that message out further, doing prospecting, continuing the shift to digital. We still spend a lot of money on print, and we're always questioning that, and I think it goes back to the segmentation. I think if you go back, you all answered that you weren't segmenting. I'm sure just previous attendees and new attendees and prospecting, and if you're in one location versus another, you're probably doing some form of segmentation, and you need to build on that. And that's really where we're headed this year, is how do we build on that? We were very basic in some of our segmentation along the way. We had the personas there, but we were focused member, non-member, but we're changing that up, and that's going to be a big part of what we do different this year.
All right, so now we are really the only thing between you and your cocktail party or your breakfast if you're watching on the live screen or broadcast. So four things. What do you do with all this information? I mean, this is a ton of information we shared. You can take it home and read it. We wanted to give you four sort of practical things you can do starting today to begin to explore whether you should be doing something with your event or what you should be doing with your event. The first is this. Use this 6 R's lens. Begin to think about which of these R's is most relevant for your current situation, your current event, and for your association. And begin to understand how are you measuring achievement against these R's. How do you know you're reaching the right people? How do you know if you're relevant or what your retention rate is, or do you do net promoter score, whatever the case might be? If you begin to shift your lens to the 6 R's, I promise you the decisions you make around your event are going to be different. We also think you should start thinking about the 9 P's and which one needs the most work. What gets the attention now? What's being ignored now? We don't ever talk about the promotion, or we don't ever talk about packaging, or we don't ever talk about the purpose of our event or what job it's being hired to do. There isn't one of these that's necessarily more important than the other. You need to talk about all 9 of them. But if you begin to understand maybe sort of where you're spending a disproportionate amount of your time in your event, you'll begin to understand what needs to change. Thirdly, we'd say start with your people. Start with your audience. Find out what you know about your audience now, and then know a little more. You don't have to go as far as DMA did, but go as far as you can take it to begin to create a customized experience, customized marketing, whatever the case might be, so that when Craig Wood shows up at your show, it's a unique experience for me. Challenge yourself to do that. Do what Martha Rogers and Dom Peppers talked about years ago by creating a picket fence and just take one segment and start to treat them differently. You don't have to do it to everybody right away. And then the last thing we'd remind you is it's never just about the event. You all, many of you might be meeting planners, many of you might have events as your primary job, but for your organization and for your continued career, think about it as more than just the event. What else needs to be maximized to make sure your event hits its potential? And where is your board and leadership? Are they as courageous? Are they as convicted? Are they as committed as the DMA board was to do something different to help not just the event, but the association? All right, so that takes us almost to time. Couple of things. First of all, while you guys have a second, we are going to send you this. So if you want it, you can either drop your cards off to us, you can send me or Neil an email. We will send you this exact deck. We'll also send you a copy of the Convene article that's on this here. We also have some hard copies in the back if you'd like it. But we're happy to take some questions if you guys want for a couple of minutes before we close. I know those of you live streaming on the broadcast, we'd be happy to address those as well during this period of time. So question up here on the front, yes.
This is for Neil. What would you say was the hardest part of the process for you?
And would you introduce yourself, Jean?
I'm sorry. Hi, I'm Jean Prokop with the American Institute of Architects.
Thank you.
It's a massive change. We made a significant change. It was a cultural change, and I think you could ask me very specific tactical questions about how we executed and things that were harder. I think the biggest challenge was changing the culture of the organization and the group that I work with. And we shifted gears several times along the way, but really getting everybody to buy in. We talked about that moving from one thing to another. That was a really good exercise for us, and we did it in a visual way. We spent a day in the office in Washington ripping pictures out of magazines, made a mess out of the offices at 360, and put them up on the wall. What did we see the event and the association as today, and where did we want to be? And when you're all sitting in a room and you've all got different perceptions, but you start to see it come alive, that kind of helped the team come together. And getting to a new name was a huge point for us as well. I didn't think it was the most challenging name to go with because I felt like it had a story, and then what for New Yorker, or everybody has an and then. You go to college and then you get your first job and then you get your second job. So DMA has an end then, the conference and the event have an end then, all of our attendees do. So, but all of that helped feed the cultural shift. That was, so that's the bit long answer to your easy question.
Hi, I'm Sarah Bolm with the American Bar Association. So we were founded in 1878, so there you go. Anyway, our association in its very nature is ridiculously segmented by areas of practice to the nth degree in these areas of practice. So what my question is and what we're struggling with is our annual meeting, when we have these tracks for practice groups or committee meetings and that types of thing, they become very popular, and then what happens is they just want to spin off and do their own meeting, and we're losing the relevance of one annual meeting of the association. So how do you combat that?
We share the same challenge. I said at the beginning, we manage six different events. We were down here last year, and we'll be here in June for the Marketing Analytics Conference. So we do have very focused events. We've reinstituted what we call communities within the organization. We gave them a place at the event. We bring them into the programming committee. You know, who's our faculty, if you will. That's a big piece of it. But you got, if you want to continue doing something big, my recommendation is identify the biggest segments. To Craig's point, you got to start somewhere. So, you know, we're looking at what's important for us. Well, attendees are important. What's more important than an attendee is a client-side marketer or brand. And then within the client-side marketers and brands, what business categories are coming in force to the event? So if it's financial services and retail and two or three others, we're going to pay a lot of attention there. Our topics can cut across a little more easily, probably. You know, talking about social or analytics, it can cut across categories, but we share the same challenge.
You did hit on it. You said it's not relevant to be brought back together as a big group. That's got to change. So what's the value proposition of bringing it together? What do they get together as an ecosystem and legal that you can't get in these specialized meetings that they're having? And that's a challenge. It's something you're going to have to uncover in a way and treat the segment as a whole while they continue to sort of go into those small specialized specialties. So we have time for one more question over here. Yes.
Hi, my name is Shelley Martinek from the Association of Progressive Rental Organizations based here in Austin. And one of the things that stood out to me was the high percentage of non-members and new people that attended your show. And my question is, were they marketing people that you just didn't have in your database? They are new marketing people you found, or did you reach a new segment of your industry that wasn't your typical database person?
A bit of a combination of the two. They were definitely marketers, and more on the supply side than the client side than I would have preferred. We're still wrestling with a relatively low percentage of client-side marketers in the turnout. But the new segment that's turning out is on the analytics and the programmatic, the much more heavily digital-driven areas. And Amanda toured 20-plus agencies in Boston. Agencies are important for us, too, and I think we saw a little bit better turnout from the agency side as well. And the agencies we look at them as on the supply side, but they can turn out a lot of the brands. They're somewhere in between for us. So,
thank you. So we're at time. First of all, I want you guys to please give a warm thank you to Neil for sharing as much as he was willing to share.